welcome to a brand new episode of the Jampack Report today for August the 31st of 2020. Of course, my name is Samuel Adams, and this is a daily gaming news podcast meant to bring you the hottest news you need to know from around the industry, hosted on YouTube and podcast services around the world 5 days a week. It is your one-stop shop for everything you need to know. So if you enjoy the show and you like what you see, hit that subscribe button and keep coming back for more. But today, Ubisoft leaked some information about the next generation PlayStation. It looks like it won't be compatible with PS3, PS2, or PS1 games. Now, of course, they do point out in this Polygon article that Sony had never promised backward compatibility for PlayStation, PlayStation 2, and PlayStation 3 games on the PlayStation 5. Let's make that very clear. But reports from July speculated about the possibility of wide-ranging backward compatibility on the PlayStation 5 playable from a cloud-based game library. Those reports were based on patent filings in Japan, not something that Sony had announced. PlayStation 5 will support the overwhelming majority of the more than 4,000 PlayStation 4 titles released to date. Sony Senior VP of Platform Planning and Management Hideaki Nishino said in March amid confusion about Sony's plans. Several game developers have already pledged to support PS4 versions of their games on PS5, including CD Projekt Red's Cyberpunk 2077 and Treyarch/Raven Software's Call of Duty Black Ops Cold War. It is worth mentioning that any game published after July on the PlayStation 4 was required to be playable on the PlayStation 5, so any of this season's big releases are going to be playable. Now, of course, Polygon has reached out to Sony for clarification on the extent of PlayStation 5's backward compatibility, but ultimately, this was something that we could all kind of assume, and I see a lot of people around the industry and online up in arms about the fact that Sony is not supporting full backward compatibility on the PlayStation 5, and you really think they would have said something by now if they were going that route, specifically in the world of marketing. If you look at what the Xbox Series X is bringing to the table, they are touting the ability to play thousands of games across the entire Xbox family, from the original Xbox all the way up through the Xbox 360 and into the Xbox One. And so if Sony was able to counter that with the ability to play classic PS2, PS1, and PS3 games, they certainly would have done so. And so this isn't really a shocker, but this is the first confirmation we have seen from anybody that is a very, very reputable source in the gaming industry. And again, this is all coming to us from a frequently asked questions on the official Ubisoft page. Now, that page has since removed the paragraph from the associated FAQ, but the fact still stands that it was posted and it was pretty blunt about exactly what they were saying, because it seems PS4 will be compatible, but PS3, PS2, and PS1 will not. But moving on, Nintendo has delayed the release of planned 3D Mario Switch remasters beyond the mascot's upcoming 35th birthday. This, of course, is according to reputable Nintendo podcast Nate the Hate, which most recently correctly outed both August Indie World Showcase and Nintendo Direct Mini before they were announced. As reported by VGC in March, the Mario Switch remasters are set to see Super Mario 64, Super Mario Sunshine, and Super Mario Galaxy release as part of an anniversary compilation originally planned to coincide with the Nintendo mascot's 35th birthday on September 13th, 2020. A deluxe version of Wii U's 3D World is also planned. According to credited Nintendo insider Drake, and corroborated by VGC's own sources, Nintendo's original plan for the 3D collection was for a June E3 announcement and celebration leading up to the planned opening of the Super Nintendo World theme park in Japan. However, these plans were eventually disrupted by the COVID-19 pandemic, with E3 2020 canceled and the Nintendo theme park's opening postponed. In a potential further disruption, Drake claimed the Switch remasters would now release beyond Mario's actual birth month and closer to Christmas. Quote, "I think now it's going to be positioned more as a holiday game than as they had originally planned," the insider said in a new podcast. "I believe the original plan was that the 3D collection was going to come out in September, had these games been announced in June. Then we probably would have had 3D World Deluxe follow it in either October or maybe even early November. Now that's completely scrapped." Although the releases may have slipped, the insider indicated that the announcement of both 3D Mario Remasters and 3D World Deluxe would happen in September to coincide with Mario's 35th anniversary. Quote, then we're potentially looking at 3D Collection either being early October, or the 3D Collection is going to come out in November and be positioned as a prime holiday title with a Mario-themed console, dock, and all of that, he said. Then I think you're going to see 3D World Deluxe get delayed out of the 35th anniversary party, and it's going to come out in January 2021. Nintendo has significantly scaled back its marketing of game announcements in 2020, partly due to complications around remote working. Nintendo did not hold a June Nintendo Direct this year, and there has not been a full Direct broadcast since September 2019, with the platform holder instead deciding to air smaller streams mostly focused on individual titles such as Animal Crossing and Smash Bros. Currently, the platform holder only has one announced title with a confirmed release date, October's Pikmin 3 Deluxe, which was announced this month via a press release and not its usual Direct model. So this is a very big follow-up to a story that broke earlier this year. This was supposed to be a very big year for Nintendo, and in a lot of ways, it still has. The Nintendo Switch is repeatedly one of the best-selling consoles, in fact, the best-selling console month after month, because as the PlayStation 4 and Xbox One wind down, the Nintendo Switch is still going strong. With both the regular version of the console and the Nintendo Switch Lite selling well, it seems that that trend is going to continue, and of course, Pikmin 3 Deluxe is a very big game for this holiday season, but to see these remasters potentially get released sometime this year is a very big piece of news that could certainly skew the console sales this holiday season whenever parents and grandparents are shopping for kids on Black Friday and then the holiday shopping season. You are going to be seeing a lot more Nintendo Switch consoles, so if you could potentially, say, get a 3D Mario remaster bundle for $60 with three of the best Mario games ever made, that's a very big deal. So I would love to see this actually become a reality, specifically the Super Mario Sunshine remaster. I would love to get my hands on that, and that might even get me to go all out and buy a Nintendo Switch Lite. But in the meantime, you could be playing the Mass Effect trilogy, but it seems the unannounced Mass Effect trilogy might slip out of its unannounced October release date. There is going to be a Mass Effect Trilogy remaster in the next 6 months or so. That is a drum the Game Beats Jeff Grubb has been banging for a while now. Grubb has knowledge of EA's plans to get the Shepard Trilogy remastered and released by the end of the fiscal year, March 31st, 2021. On a recent Games Beat podcast embedded above, Grubb says that EA might have been forced to push the Mass Effect Trilogy back from a planned October launch, as reported by Video Games Chronicle. Up until like this last week, I know the plan for sure was to announce it in early October, release in later October, he states. However, Grubb goes on to say that his sources think maybe COVID-related issues will put a temporary damper on those plans. Grubb adds, I think they were planning to have this Mass Effect trilogy be the other big thing for $60 this holiday alongside Star Wars Squadrons, so that's why I'm still pretty confident it will make it out. But with everything else falling apart, like across the board, I could see them also wanting to just delay. Here are some potential targets. It could launch in October as intended. It could slip to November the 7th, aka N7 Day, which is a Saturday and not a traditionally good day to launch video games. However, EA might want to steer clear of getting current gen remasters on shelves that close to new consoles. That's why it might just move to 2021 altogether. As for PS5 and Xbox Series X taking the wind out of the remaster sales, it should not be too much of an issue. Both next-gen machines will run the previous console's games, meaning that these Mass Effects will be automatically backward compatible, so to speak. Mass Effect Trilogy Remaster, scheduled for October release but could slip, a journalist claims, writes the official report from Video Games Chronicle. So, this is not the best look for the Mass Effect Trilogy. I'm not going to beat around the bush. I would love to see the Mass Effect Trilogy get the full Xbox Series X and PlayStation 5 upgrade. I think that it is foolish to release three very, very beloved games on what is going to soon be legacy hardware. Now, again, this is not going to really put a damper on the overall reception of the games themselves, assuming they are in good shape, because the Mass Effect trilogy is still very, very beloved, and we don't talk about Mass Effect Andromeda. And so if these games do launch, it is certainly going to be a very popular game this holiday season, and I like the idea of releasing it on N7 Day. But at the same time, could this potentially skew other people from actually going out and getting the Xbox Series X and the PlayStation 5 on day one? With the Mass Effect trilogy, you could potentially hold out 6 months, maybe even a year or so if you play other games on current-gen hardware, and wait for more next-gen games to come out on the PlayStation 5 and the Xbox Series X before jumping in. And I think that is something that a lot of people might consider, because again, the Mass Effect trilogy has long been rumored and very long been desired. So we will continue to follow up on this, but it is a very strange season indeed for video game releases. I would not be surprised to see this one pushed all the way back into March of 2021, and you might even see it upgraded to the PlayStation 5 and the Xbox Series X. That could be the reason that they are trying to push it back even further. And I would love to see that move as well. But Ubisoft, going back to them, has a game called Gods and Monsters. At least that's what it was before the name was changed, as confirmed earlier this year. But now it seems to have been renamed to the edgier Immortals Fenyx Rising. And the author at Destructoid says, "I was fine with the original. I agree completely. It was a hectic time, but it was our hectic time together. A time when we could all come together, potentially take off work and chill for a few days and talk about games nonstop ahead of Burst. Instead of Burst. But back in June of 2019, Ubisoft talked Gods and Monsters, billed as a full-on cartoony Assassin's Creed that was centered around mythological beasts. A lot of people were not into that, but I was intrigued," the author says. "Fast forward to mid-2020, and we still don't have any real info about it, but that might change soon. Discovered by Gamatsu, the Taiwanese ratings board has seemingly outed a new name for the game, Immortals Fenyx Rising. The PC, PS4, Xbox One, and Switch platforms fall under that rating. The prevailing thought is that following a Stadia preview snafu, which we can likely add to the list of platforms, the game will launch sometime in 2021. To me, this seems like an obvious candidate to reintroduce to the world during the next Ubisoft Forward stream, which is happening at some point in the future. In fact, it seems that it will be happening within about a week or so, according to industry insiders. But this is one of my most anticipated Ubisoft games. I love the look of Gods and Monsters, and I really wish that they had just kept that name. But essentially, it combines Assassin's Creed with Breath of the Wild, and that's kind of the experience that you look to be getting. But I think this is probably going to get some more information, because the game itself was outed on the the Google Stadia platform earlier this year, and people actually got to play it, or at least an early build of it very early on, which means that it's getting pretty deep in development, and it does seem like a pretty prominent release to get out ASAP. Because again, if this is just coming to the PS4, the Xbox One, the Switch, and the PC, you really want to get that one out as soon as possible, as these current generation consoles, or at least the flagship current gen consoles, are on their way out the door. But Immortals Fenyx Rising could be getting a full reveal later on in the month, and again, that is the new name, supposedly, for Ubisoft's Gods and Monsters. Now moving on, Halo Infinite has Monster Energy weapons just in case you needed a good dose of corporate capitalism for your Monday. In a move that will shock absolutely no one, Microsoft recently announced that Halo Infinite will feature guns sponsored by Monster Energy. The news comes from an official Xbox blog post, which opens by discussing the recently launched Halo Infinite multiplayer Monster Energy cans. While these real-life cans are emblazoned with the stern visage of Mr. John Halo, there was no reciprocal instance of Monster appearing in the virtual realm of Halo Infinite until now. You can check out the screen grab below, which offers us a look at the official Halo Infinite Monster Energy guns, and you guessed it, they are very, very green. They don't actually look too bad at first. The green and black palette is aligned with Combat Evolved era Master Chief, and there is no piss-colored M on the front of the guns. However, after about half a second of looking at them, I can confirm that I personally will not be using a Halo Infinite Monster Energy weapon skin unless it is for occasional, intentionally ironic purposes. Players can also earn double XP boost by purchasing cans of Monster with Master Chief on the front. Each can is good for one boost, so if you get a 24-pack of Monster, please don't, you'll hurt your teeth, you will get 24 individual double XP boost lasting 30 minutes each. That is according to the blog post. The maximum amount of double XP hours one person can earn is 60, but that means you will need to buy 120 cans of Monster, and that is way too much Monster. Instead of spending all your money on caffeinated sugar water, you can check out the mod that allows you to play as a grunt in Halo Combat Evolved, which of course you can browse to your liking on VG 24/7. But if you look at the gun models themselves, that's your first look at the weaponry that we are going to be getting in Halo Infinite, at least from a customization style menu perspective. Looks like a pretty cool little weapon model there. But ultimately, this is a big marketing campaign that has been derailed completely by COVID-19 and the delay of Halo Infinite. This game was supposed to launch this holiday season. So let's say that the Halo Infinite cans begin hitting at the beginning of September. You have 2 months to save up double XP, and then you could potentially get the game in November, which is when we are going to be seeing the Series X release. So that didn't end up happening, but it seems that the promotional material is all made and lined up in the distribution chain. So now they have to do kind of a buy Monster Energy cans now, play the game whenever it comes out in 2021. Not the best look. But regardless, if you are looking forward to Halo Infinite, there is your Monster Energy content that you can unlock if you are in the market for some of that sweet, sweet double XP. But to round out today's show, Call of Duty Warzone cheat maker apologizes and closes after legal threats. Now, this is just a brief story that I wanted to run through because, of course, cheaters are very, very prevalent in Call of Duty Warzone, and I always like the opportunity to remind people that cheaters never win. Legal threats from Activision have apparently caused a cheat maker for Call of Duty Modern Warfare on PC to pull its wares and apologize to the COD community. As spied by Reddit and reported by Eurogamer this weekend, CXCheat.net notified its users, who paid up to $60 for cheats, that it was removing all Call of Duty products or services sold through the site. Development of and support for these cheats was also terminated per an agreement with Activision. The message was captured in a Discord chat that has since gone offline. One of the developers warned customers that using third-party tools in Call of Duty may result in suspension or banning of your account, and further, we apologize for any pain we have caused to players of Call of Duty. Polygon could not find any lawsuit brought in federal court by Activision in the past 4 years against any cheat maker, and of course, Polygon has reached out for more comment. But CXCheat.net was inaccessible at the time of publication. Let's try and go there now. Since I am the star-studded journalist that we are today, it looks like it's still down. Oh, look at that. Eurogamer reported this weekend that when it was still up, CXCheat.net still had cheats for Apex Legends and PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds available. One customer complained in the since-deleted Discord of spending $60 on a Modern Warfare cheat and wanting a refund. Just a reminder, cheaters never win. I want to make that very clear. Now, you could make a lot of money on the front end. You could ruin a publisher's game in some regard. But ultimately, the player base knows whenever somebody cheats, and nobody likes a cheater. That's just my opinion in that one. But it seems like it's a pretty popular opinion. However, that rounds out today's episode of the Jampack Report. If you enjoyed today's show, drop me a like down below and let me know what you think about everything we talked about here today. I would love to hear your thoughts on the PlayStation 5 not being backward compatible with any other games outside of the PlayStation 4 generation. On top of that, would you be down for some Mario remasters on the Nintendo Switch, or do you want that hot Mass Effect trilogy? Would love to hear what you have to say. But until tomorrow, you guys have a fantastic rest of your night. I'll talk to you soon, and peace. Peace.